Help us to receive this message from Glenn and let it touch everyone that it needs to touch, Lord. Be with us today as we hear these words. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Once again, I'd like to welcome you to worship and also like to welcome those that are now joining us on our live stream. We are continuing our study of Paul's letter to the church at Rome, and we are now in chapter 11. And so our scripture reading will begin with verse 1, and as we read it, as always, I would remind you this is the Word of God, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And may we invite the Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts, to give us insight and understanding, to inspire us. And the only way that we can ever understand it is if the Holy Spirit does so. And so let us read Romans chapter 11, beginning with verse 1. I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah? How he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I'm the only one left, and they're trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer by works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. What then? What Israel sought so earnestly, it did not obtain. But the elect did. The others were hardened, as it is written. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see and ears that could not hear to this very day. And David says, may their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see and their backs be bent forever. Let us pray as we seek God's guidance. Lord, we come before you. And I acknowledge that I am utterly dependent upon you. I know I cannot teach this word. And so I ask the anointing power of your Holy Spirit. I ask for your cleansing, that you would make me fit for your use. I pray for your people, Lord. You know where each and every one of us are in our journey with you. You know what we are needing to hear. And Lord, I know that, well, I cannot speak to every need of every heart. Your Holy Spirit can. And so, Lord, we invite you to speak to us. And it's in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Well, we now come to an extremely important question, and one that seems to be so relevant for what's going on in our world today. What about Israel? Since they have rejected Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, rejected his atoning sacrificial death and his resurrection, and all of the evidence that Jesus is the Messiah, because they've turned a deaf ear, does that mean that God has rejected his people, the people of Israel? And the answer to that question is not only important to Israel, it is also important to us, the Church of Jesus Christ. And as Paul answers this question, he emphatically declares that God has not rejected the nation of Israel. In spite of the fact that they have rejected Jesus Christ, God has not rejected them. Paul says in verses 1 and 2, I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. See, I think it's extremely important for us to understand that part of this is that God is in covenant with Israel and that God will be faithful to his promises. When we or when Israel are unfaithful, it doesn't mean that God is going to be unfaithful. I know that may be a part of our human nature. I've seen this take place in perhaps a marriage where one spouse is unfaithful and so the other one decides they're going to be unfaithful. Well, God doesn't operate like we do as human beings. God is faithful, and he's faithful to his covenant. As the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy, if we are faithless, he will remain faithful, for he cannot disown himself. In other words, it is not in the nature of God to withdraw his promise. He cannot and he will not take back what he gives. And so the Bible assures us that God is not a man that he might lie, or a son of man that he might change his mind. When God makes a promise, it is a promise. It is an eternal promise. And so God has not rejected his chosen people, the people of Israel. And so in this, there are two important facts that we really need to understand. The first is this: God is not finished with Israel. He has a plan for them. He has a purpose for them. And there are things that are yet to come in the Bible that talks about where we know Israel is going to be an intricate part of it. For example, we know that in the last days there'll be 144,000 Jews that are set aside as the servants of God. Now, I personally think that means there are going to be 144,000 Jewish men and women that are going to be going out into this world, and they are going to be like the mighty Apostle Paul proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ in the short time that will be left. We know that in the last days, all the nations are going to come against Israel, and that God will miraculously deliver her. We know that there are promises that God has made to Israel that are awaiting their fulfillment, and God will be faithful to the last detail of each and every one of those promises. I think the fact that Israel has been scattered among the nations for over 1,900 years, a people without a homeland, and where with most nations, when they get scattered from their homeland, they just disappear from history altogether. But that didn't happen with the people of Israel. And then in 1948, God miraculously returns them to their homeland. They are a nation, and they are in their own homeland. I think that's the evidence that God wants Israel around. You see, their history alone is sufficient to know that God has not rejected his chosen people, the people of Israel. And God has promised that he will never forsake them. Now, I think we need to understand what that means to us as the church as well. Because God's faithfulness to Israel is the assurance that God is going to be faithful to those of us who are in covenant with him through the blood of Jesus Christ. Even at times when we may have been unfaithful, God is faithful. And he is faithful to those of us who are in covenant with him through Christ. And he's given us great promises. He's given us the promise of redemption, the promise of the forgiveness of our sins. He's given us the promised Holy Spirit. And as the church of Christ, we are also awaiting the fulfillment of promises that he has made to us. Promises like when we will be resurrected from the dead. Promises of being glorified, having a glorified body, and entering into the eternal kingdom of God, and so much more. And so God's faithfulness to Israel declares that God is going to be faithful to us. And it gives us the assurance of the covenant that we are in with him through Jesus Christ. As evidence of God's faithfulness, Paul presents himself. He says, just consider what God has done for me. See, God has not cast off his people concerning their personal salvation. There's no doubt that Paul was a Jew. He even declares that once again here when he says that he is a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. And if you remember Paul's story, it was God who sought him out. Paul hated the church. He set out to pursue and to persecute the church and the believers in Jesus Christ. And it was God who pursued him, and he met the risen Lord on the road to Damascus. And not only did he meet the Lord there, it was then that he was given an assignment that he would be the apostle to the Gentiles. And what Paul is saying is that he is just one of many who are Jewish who have come to faith in Jesus Christ throughout the last 20 centuries. Next, he uses the prophet Elijah as an example. In chapter 11, beginning with verse 2, he says, "Don't you know what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah? How he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I am the only one left, and they're trying to kill me." And what was God's answer to him? "I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed a knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, it is no longer by works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace." See, there was a time when the mighty prophet Elijah thought that he was the only one left in all of Israel that was faithful to the Lord. If you remember part of his story, it actually begins 3 years prior to that, when God allowed him to pray that there would be no rain on Israel. And so it hasn't rained for 3 years. And all of this was so that the people might know that he is God. And then Elijah challenges the prophets of Baal. He goes to the king, Ahab. He says, "I think it's time to put this all to an end. I want to challenge the prophets of Baal on the top of Mount Carmel. So you just get them together. It'll be the prophets of Baal against me." And so on the top of Mount Carmel, they all ascended. There were 400 prophets of Baal and 450 prophets and prophetesses of Asherah. That was Baal's counterpart. And then they're all here against Elijah. And Elijah says, here's the rules. You build an altar to Baal. You put the wood on it. We'll get two bulls. You pick whichever one you want to sacrifice. I'll build an altar to the Lord. I'll put my wood on it. I'll put the sacrifice on it. And then we pray for God to consume it by fire. And so you go first. And so the prophets do. They build the altar to Baal. They put the wood on it. They cut up the sacrifice. They put it on. And then they began praying to Baal for him to consume the sacrifice. Now here's something you need to understand with this. Baal was a fertility god. It hasn't rained for 3 years. There is no fertility in a land when it's not raining. And so since he's a fertility god, and if you've ever seen the little statues that they had of Baal, he even had a lightning bolt in his hand. And so this was completely in line with what they thought Baal ought to be able to do. And so they began praying and nothing happens. And then Elijah begins to taunt them. I mean, he knew how to do trash talk. He could have been in the NFL. I mean, if he had been, though, he would have been penalized for taunting. Because that's exactly what he began doing with them. Maybe you need to pray a little bit louder. Maybe he's still asleep. Maybe he's gone to the bathroom. Maybe he just can't hear you. Shout a little bit louder. And they did. All morning long, they worked themselves up into a frenzy, asking Baal to consume that sacrifice. And nothing happens. They head into the afternoon, and they get later into the afternoon, and still nothing has happened. And so Elijah says, Perkins paraphrase, it's my turn. And so he gets 12 uncut stones, one for each tribe of Israel. And he places those stones and he creates an altar. He puts the wood on top of it. He cuts up the sacrifice, he puts it on. And then he does something really weird. If you don't think it's weird yet. He has a trench dug around the altar. And then he has them go with these jars and bring water. And he douses it with water. I mean, he has covered it. The wood has been covered. The sacrifice is covered. The stones are covered. The trench is filled up with water. And then he simply prays. And wham! God consumes the sacrifice from fire from heaven, and it licks up the water and everything. And then Elijah commands the people of Israel to seize the prophets of Baal. They do. They take them down the mountain and he slaughters them. Because in Israel, that was the penalty for worshiping a false god. And now we know who God is. Elijah then goes back up on the mountain and he prays for rain. He sends his assistant to go and to tell King Ahab, you better get home quick because it's about to rain. And then he takes off running and he even outruns Ahab in his chariot. And there is a downpour. And so Elijah goes off into the wilderness or the Judean desert. Ahab goes home and he tells his wife Jezebel about all that's happened. Now it was Jezebel who brought the prophets of Baal in. And she is mad. She's beside herself, and she wants the prophet put to death. And so she begins having a pursuit of this prophet, wanting this man dead. So Elijah's in the desert, and here's a strange thing, and you need to really understand this, because when you have been on a high, you can't stay there. Now, can you imagine if you prayed and God consumed that offering and you prayed and God made it rain? Man, that'll put you on an emotional high. It will put you on a spiritual high. And you can't stay there. And so all alone in the desert, Elijah comes down. And he's feeling depressed. Now, it has nothing to do with faith. That's just a natural response of the human body. I've heard people say he went to the desert and had a pity party, which means you know nothing about human emotions. But he is there and he is down. And then he does begin to pray. And he says, Lord, they've killed all of your prophets. I'm the only one left in all of Israel, and now they're trying to kill me. So the Lord feeds him. And then he tells him to prepare for his journey, and he sends him down into the Sinai, which also is a desert. And then he goes into the Sinai, and God says, I'm going to speak to you. And so he's waiting for God to speak, and there's an earthquake, and he thinks, that's God speaking, but it wasn't God in the earthquake. Then there was a mighty wind, and that wasn't the voice of God. And then there was that small, still voice that says, I have reserved for myself 7,000 in Israel who have never bowed a knee to Baal. You see, Elijah, the mighty prophet of God, forgot three important things. Now, here's the thing. If Elijah forgot them, then we can forget them as well. And these are three things that we really need to be guarding against in our own lives. See, the first thing that Elijah forgot is that we have limited knowledge. Now, I know we don't like to admit that. We like to think that we see everything and that we know everything. But the reality is we don't. We don't see it all. We don't understand all of the issues, which means that things are never as bad as it looks. See, to Elijah, it looked real bad. I'm the only one that is left. He didn't know that there were 7,000 in Israel who were faithful to the Lord as well. And sometimes when we think we know it all, we don't know nearly as much as we think we do. We have a limited knowledge. And so that means things are never as bad as it looks. He also forgot about God's unlimited power. See, the reason the situation is never as bad as it looks is because God is never as weak as it seems. We often think that God is losing the battle or has lost the battle. And in reality, what God is doing is using the opposition of the enemy to fulfill his purpose. Let me give you an example. Go to Calvary. It looks like the enemy is winning and God is losing when Jesus is arrested. It looks that way when Jesus is being beaten, and I imagine the disciples felt that way. It looks that way when Jesus is dying on a cross. And yet what God was doing was using the opposition of the enemy to fulfill his purpose so that Jesus could be our atoning sacrifice, die on that cross, be buried, and be raised from the dead. God was never losing in that. God cannot lose. You know, I've often heard it said, and I've said it too, and it's really kind of erroneous in that it doesn't have the whole truth. It's not that it's wrong, but maybe you've said this, I know who wins in the end. That implies they're not winning now, that somehow God's going to make a comeback. God's not behind. God is always winning. See, that's where we fail to have that, and we have that limited knowledge that we even think God could even be losing. God always wins. He is always winning. He cannot lose. And if God is winning, then there is no reason for despair. And so concerning Israel, he says, God's purpose will be fulfilled. Now that's true concerning everything that is God's purpose. It will be fulfilled. Now, Elijah also forgot that you cannot mix grace and works. And it was like the old proverbial saying, you can't mix oil and water. And you can't mix grace and works. They do not mix. See, if salvation is by grace, then it cannot be by works. And if it's by works, it cannot be by grace. And if it's by grace, then it cannot be grace plus something else. It's not grace plus works. You can't add to something that's perfect. Now, we get these really bizarre thoughts into our heads at times. I hear this especially in sports. You'll watch a game and a player will do particularly well and they'll say, boy, he gave 110% today. No, he didn't. You don't have 110%. If you give it all, you only have 100%. Now, I know what they're saying, that he upped his game that day, that he lived up more to his potential than perhaps we've seen him do in the past. But he didn't give 110% because you can't. Why? Because you can't add to perfection and we can't add to ourselves. I know this one's kind of stupid, and I think I've shared it before. But I learned in school that 2 + 2 = 4. Now, if I had somehow thought, I can do better than that. Next test, I'm going to do better. When they ask me what 2 + 2 is, I'm going to make it 5, because 5 is more. That's making it better. If I had done something that stupid, you know exactly what my teacher would have done. You don't improve on it, you destroy it. You can't improve on perfection, and you cannot improve on grace. And when you try to improve on the grace of God, you destroy the very grace of God. And so you can't add any kind of works to the grace of God. And so for our salvation and our covenant, when Jesus Christ was on the cross and he said it is finished, or it is paid in full, it meant the debt is fully paid. There's nothing else left to pay. That's what grace does. Now, it is true. Real faith, genuine faith, will result in works, but works are not the saving factor. And Elijah forgot that. Now, concerning Israel, Paul goes on and he talks about the results of unbelief in verse 7 and following. What then? What Israel sought so earnestly, it did not obtain, but the elect did. The others were hardened. As it is written, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes so that they could not see, ears so that they could not hear, to this very day. And David says, may their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block, a retribution for them. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see, and their backs be bent forever. Now, as we've already noted, God has not rejected Israel, yet most of Israel has turned away from him. And he says, when unbelief comes in, there are 3 results of that unbelief. And the first one, he says, is that Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking. You see, what Israel so earnestly sought after was to obtain righteousness. And they did so by trying to keep the law, observing their religious ceremonies, and even to the point of observing the man-made traditions. They were seeking after a righteousness that comes by works. And they failed to understand even what the prophet Isaiah had declared to them, that our righteousness is like filthy rags. I mean, if you take the best of us, or when we do our best, in the sight of God, our righteousness is nothing more than filth. We have no righteousness of our own. And he says, there's not a one of us righteous, not a single one. And yet what he says is there is a small remnant that discovered that righteousness that comes by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. The second result, he says, of the unbelief is that it is accompanied by a hardness of heart, spiritual blindness, spiritual deafness. You see, when you hear the truth, you have got to do something with it. And if you don't, you lose your ability to recognize truth. If you hear the truth and you do nothing with it, you become blind, or you can't hear it. And it's not that God arbitrarily blinds people to the truth. He's saying it is the result of rejecting the truth. It's just like the law of gravity. If you step off of a cliff, the law of gravity is going to come into effect. It's like the law of thirst. If you go into the desert without any water, the law of thirst is going to come into effect. And so if you leave God's truth and you follow after your own truth, the law of blindness comes into effect. And you will get to the point you don't even recognize the truth. It doesn't even look like truth to you. In fact, that explains a lot of what's going on around us today. People that have had the truth have rejected the truth, and so this spiritual blindness sets in, and they no longer even recognize truth. And the third result is, he says, the blessing became a snare. Their table became a snare and a trap. The blessing became a stumbling block. And the blessing for Israel, the food of the table, was the law, the scriptures. You see, God had given to Israel something that he had never given to any other nation. No other nation on the earth possessed the law of God. No other nation had the temple worship that God gave to them. No other nation had the sacrificial system that God gave to Israel. And yet, rather than focusing on the relationship that was intended, they focused on a legalistic religion that resulted in bondage. The blessing became a trap. Now, I think what we need to learn are there's times when we as the church can make the same kind of mistakes. See, it's not just Israel that's made a mistake. As we look at what goes on around us in our world today and what we see going on in many of the churches, we know that we can make the same kinds of mistakes. See, so often we fail to obtain what we were seeking. We hear the command of Jesus to go and make disciples, and somehow we change that to think that it was all about numbers. And so we began thinking that numbers were important or butts in pews. Instead of telling people about Jesus, we wanted to tell people about the church. People don't need to hear about the church. Doesn't matter how wonderful your church is. People need Jesus, not the church. Now the church is there to help, but it's Jesus that people need. You see, we were given a mission and we failed to obtain what we were seeking because it should have been about bringing people to Jesus to be disciples of Jesus. And so since we focused on numbers, we thought in order to obtain numbers, then what we are going to have to do is we're going to have to water down the truth or we're going to have to sugarcoat it because the truth can be really hard to accept at times. I mean, the Bible even says that. It says some of it is like milk and some of it's like bread and the other's like strong meat. And because we didn't think people could chew on some strong meat, we just decided to sugarcoat a little bit of it. And so we give them chocolate milk instead. Something sweetened up a little bit instead of the real thing. And as a result, in much of what we see going on in our world today, is we have turned the grace of God into a license for sin and immorality. See, there are times when we probably feel like Elijah. We see all of the darkness that is increasing in our world today. We see where fewer and fewer people are actually coming into worship. And then we're tempted to think, well, I'm the only one that's left. There's just a few of us left. And that's simply not true. See, we need to remember that we have a limited knowledge. And it's not as bad as it seems. Oh, it looks bad in this country. Oh, but there are places where the gospel is growing. And people are coming to know Jesus Christ. And they're becoming disciples of Jesus. Africa, the gospel is exploding. The Philippines, the gospel is exploding. Eastern Europe, the gospel is growing and increasing. China, where people can die, are coming to know Jesus Christ and willing to give their life. Even places like Iran, where you die if it's ever learned that you are a believer, and they're coming to know Jesus Christ. And so it's never as bad as it seems. God has unlimited power, and God is in control. And so much of what we see going on in the world around us today has to happen. It's where God is using the enemy. He's using the opposition to fulfill his purpose. Because so many of the things that we see happening, the Bible told us they have to happen. These things must happen. The Bible tells us there's going to be a great apostasy. That is a falling away of the faith. And we're seeing that. There is a falling away today. Many people who were believers just a few years ago, and you no longer see them worshiping today. Fewer and fewer people are attending worship in the United States and in much of Europe. There is an apostasy that is taking place. But God said this would happen. So many of the things that we see happening in our world around us are exactly the things that Jesus said would happen in order to bring in the return of Jesus Christ, which is another promise that God has made. I'm coming back. And there are things that are going to happen before Jesus comes back. And it's not going to be that we have a little heaven here on earth. That's not what the scriptures teach. Now, we're here now because of the grace of God, so that more might come to know him. How much time we have, only God knows. But there are also lessons we learn from Israel. And God has not rejected Israel. And God is faithful to his covenant with the church through the blood of Jesus Christ. And God is winning. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you so much for your word. We just ask that you will take it and use it in our hearts and in our lives. Lord, that you will just draw us closer to you. And it's in the name of our Lord and Savior that we pray. Amen. I invite us all to stand as we sing our closing song.